never live up to that, I'll tell you. Captain Joe mentioned that this is specifically a cruise which we do on weekends with photographers in mind. Now, for those of you who are not photographers, nothing is different. It's the same river. It's the same buildings. The only difference is we are going to stop for 3 or 4 minutes at three particularly photogenic places. We're going to stop out in the locks just before you get to Lake Michigan, so you'll get these beautiful panoramic views of the city. We're going to stop where the Chicago River, which is shaped like a capital letter Y, forks, and that's another great photo stop. And then we're going to stop where the boat generally turns around,
kind of landlocked city.
We are almost right in the middle of the continental United States. And for those of you who flew in, I'm sure that you saw the broad, flat land surrounding us, and then all of a sudden, whoop, there's this huge city in the middle of the cornfields. So what the heck are we doing here? Well, we are right at the confluence of the Great Lakes, Lake Michigan, and then the connecting all the way out to the Atlantic Ocean. And if we didn't turn our boat around and kept going on the inland system of rivers, we would actually wind up in the Mississippi River and then south to the Gulf of Mexico. So that actually makes Chicago a great port city. And in the 19th century, it was busier in this port than anywhere in the rest of the United.
You would have unfinished goods coming in, finished goods going out.
And it made this go from a kind of little frontier backwater in 1832. There were 4,000 people here. By 1871, which is the year of the Great Chicago Fire, there were 300,000 people here, and 1 million only 20 years later when we hosted the World Columbian Exposition. So the city grew very, very fast, and where we are now was actually where Lake Michigan sort of was coming in then. Slowly but surely, we've been pushing Lake Michigan out in the direction we're turning now, which is into the bright sunrise, and we know that that's pointing east. So this was actually still part of the lakeshore, and behind us from where we just turned was actually the first settlement, something called Fort Dearborn, which was founded right around the time of the American Revolutionary War, which would have been the 1770s,
up to the mouth of the
of Lake Michigan. And everything that you see here is all brand new, basically from the very late 20th century going forward. Because up until about 1950, particularly on the left-hand side of the river, you really didn't have anything that was built up there. You really just had kind of vestiges of what had once been this thriving, very commercial area for the Port of Chicago, and then which lapsed very much into complete disuse. The bridge that we're about to go under is what changed that. This went in the 1980s, and it linked these two banks of the river. And one of the first things that people did was to move to the big hulking building, which is the Sheraton Hotel. It's from 1992. But all of this back in here is the work of urban planning going on. The people who designed this particular area, which is called River East, did it with a very specific notion of a lot of interaction between Chicagoans and the river. You'll see people walking along down here. You have the little kiosks, which are lights, so it's very safe to be able to walk down here at night. And the idea here is very neighborhoody, a lot of interaction with the river. Approaching on the left, too, is one of the things that makes this such a nice kind of neighborhood sort of feel. There's a big fountain that you will see on the left. It's called the Parting of the Waters, and it was put in 1989. It's the Nicholas J. Mellis Memorial Fountain, and it has something on there also. You'll notice on the left-hand side there's a kind of a pyramid. That's the water cannon, and at certain times of the day, at the top of the hour, it shoots a jet of water out in a big arc, which actually is so strong.
These people
are
not so much looking
side
at the river as they are looking at each other, because the houses, all the apartment buildings, all sort of settle around a big 9-acre central kind of green.
So right along here and in some selected other areas along the river, the commercial has been completely overtaken by residential. While we're out today, we're going to go past the homes of probably about 45,000 Chicagoans. And I know many of you probably come from suburbs or cities that have fewer than 45,000 people in it. So this is a major kind of area. To the left-hand front of the boat, you see a dark, rounded glass building that's called Lake Point Tower. It was put in 1967, and it's actually sitting there violating the law because we worked very very diligently, led by the forces of a man named Montgomery Ward, who was a 19th century tycoon, to try to preserve Chicago's lakefront. Because after there had been a World's Fair here in 1893 with temporary buildings, a lot of people wanted to build that up. And Montgomery Ward did not think that was a good idea. He went back to the history books and found an ordinance from 1832 which stipulated that this strip of land along Chicago's lakefront was to remain forever open, free, and clear for the use of Chicagoans. You were not to build anywhere east. This is Lakeshore Drive that we're just going under. But of course, we know this is Chicago, whose politics are legend. Loopholes can always be found. One was found to put that building in, although the city then immediately closed the loophole after that. And our gorgeous open lakeshore, which in about 2 minutes you're going to be able to drink in, and that's where we're going to stop, is really a gift out onto the lake. It took 20 years, 4 lawsuits, and millions of dollars to sue the city to keep the lake. And they had a competition in the late 19th century to figure out what to do with it. And what they've turned it into is really a tourist venue. It's the most popular in terms of attendance tourist attraction in the state of Illinois. Last year, about 13 million people went there. And the Ferris wheel is actually an homage to the world's first Ferris wheel, which is at the World Columbian Exposition. We're going to get ready to turn around. When we pause, I will turn off the mic. But meanwhile, if you want to look in front, you will see how there's an opening here, and then you see gates behind it. Those are the locks. Those had to be put in when we reversed the river, which I'll tell you about, because the river is lower than Lake Michigan, and our neighbors in the Great Lakes states were afraid that this being lower, it would drain the Great Lakes, so we had to put those locks in. And they remain closed until traffic wants to go through. So we're coming around. When we start moving again, I will interpret some of the buildings for you. But right now, we have about 3 minutes for the photographers.
You're free to taking pictures if you want to.
The building I want to focus on is the building that you almost can't take your eyes off of. Straight ahead of us with the spire on top, that is Trump Tower from 2009. I used to forget the name of the building, so the Donald kindly put his name all over it last summer so that I wouldn't do that again. We want to talk about what makes tall buildings tall. You start counting at the bottom from the lowest level of pedestrian access, even if that's underground. But the big question is, where do you stop? And there's a group called the Council on Tall Buildings and Urban Habitats. They make the rules, and they said you stop where the architect stopped. So with the tall building that we're going to see later, the Willis Tower, you'll notice it has these rabbit ear antennas. Those don't count because those were added afterwards. Adrian Smith, who designed this building for the Donald, always put a spire on it of various designs and heights. And this led to a great controversy about 2 years ago when they were finishing off One World Trade Center in New York City, because it was designed to be about 300 feet or about 100 meters taller than the Willis Sears Tower. But those last feet were all empty, what architects sometimes refer to as vanity height. And we in Chicago don't like to lose any titles, and we petitioned that that height not be counted, but we were voted down. But what we do like to say is if you stand at the tallest occupied floor of the Willis Tower, and you could look across the country at the tallest occupied floor of One World Trade, you'd be looking down. The tallest building in the world is Burj Khalifa, which is in Dubai. The tallest building under construction is the Kingdom Tower in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. And both of those buildings were designed by Adrian Smith, who did this building and whose architectural practice is right here in Chicago. A very noteworthy skyscraper, though, look to the front of the building and front of the boat, slightly to the left, and you'll see a building that looks kind of like it's ruffled. It looks like it's sort of floating in the breeze, as if someone also poured some water down it. That is Aqua from 2009 by Jeannie Gang. And that really destroys all of your preconceptions of these, you know, perpendicular, very flat and boxy buildings that are skyscrapers. You'll catch it again as soon as the bridge is out of the way. Find this white square and then look just to the left. So that's Aqua, straight up, and you can really appreciate the kind of kinetic nature of it. Next to it, the boxy white building with the long ribbon of windows, that is the Aeon Tower from 1973. It was built originally for Standard Oil, and the building had a lot of bad luck. If you look at it, first of all, you'll notice that there are no windows in the corner. Well, the executives at Standard Oil were not at all happy that they couldn't get corner offices. It was also supposed to be the tallest building in Chicago, which it was for about 6 months, and then they finished what was then the Sears Tower. And what you see there is granite from Mount Airy in North Carolina. The building was originally faced with marble from Carrara in Italy. It was the same quarry that Michelangelo had used to do his sculpture of the David. The quarry was very old, so they had to take very as little marble as they could. It was very thin, and no one bothered to do any tests to determine if the climate of Chicago was in any way similar to the climate of Italy. We have these huge fluctuations of temperature. Within about 4 or 5 years, the marble was beginning to deteriorate and get thin. They had to pull it off the building before it fell off and killed somebody. It cost $1 million a floor. That was about $80 million. And it cost $120 million to build the building. So it was an extremely expensive mistake. Now you can see Aqua. If you see the triangular building, which is the Swiss Hotel, behind it, you'll now see that waviness, which is Aqua. The building underneath that is just a big old concrete box, but the magic is in these geometric forms, which are rounded, which are juxtaposed. Jeannie Gang works with about 7 different forms, but they're juxtaposed differently, so that every balcony, and you'll notice this as you come through, every balcony is unique. So the views that you have in there are absolutely unparalleled, and it enables you to have balconies that go all the way to the top, all the way to the 82nd story. You would never see that in a building which is perfectly perpendicular, because the balconies would just act like sails. They'd fly off. But here they're aerodynamic. So we have the Trump Tower up ahead of us, kind of holding court to a very important intersection in the 20th century. What did, you can see either to the left with the dark brown glassy building, or to the right, the sort of dark gray glassy building. Both of those are what we think of when we think of modern architecture. It's generally known as the international style because instead of being tied to history or geographic context, the buildings are simply tied to architecture. The way that architects always thought is to look at the past. And on the right-hand side where you see the clock tower, that building, that's the Wrigley Building, first tower 1921, second 1924 by Graham Anderson, Probst, and White. That building is obviously hearkening back to the past. Some people think France. The tower, the clock tower, however, is based on the La Giralda Tower, which is in Sevilla, Spain. On the left-hand side, you see an inward curving facade and a tower on top. That is the London Guarantee Building from 1923. Its style is called Beaux-Arts, which is French for fine arts. We think of it as neoclassical. The building is highly decorated, very symmetrical. Next to it, the building that's pink with the big rounded windows is an Art Deco building from 1928 by Holabird and Root. It has this very kind of jazzy silhouette, very stripped, very sleek, very sophisticated. That's a style that dominated between about 1923 and the London Guarantee Building. It has a kind of triumphal arch. It has the columns, the Corinthian columns, the most highly decorated order of columns. And then behind it, shooting up in the air, is a building that looks a lot like a rocket ship. That's the Mather Tower from 1928. And between it, you'll see that they are building, in a more modern style, this glassy walkway. It's because this whole block is kind of like hotel block. The London Guarantee Building is currently closed, and it will reopen next year as a hotel. Then you have the walkway, and then you have the Mather Tower, which has already been repurposed as a hotel. And next to it, you have the turquoise and gray stripy building from 1958, which has always been a hotel. So they're all right there.
It's called the Jewelers Building
because so many people who had offices in there were in the commercial jewelry trade, and they were legitimately concerned about being out on the streets of Chicago with their millions of dollars worth of gems. So the building at one point boasted an elevator which was large enough that they could drive their car right into the elevator in safety, be taken up to wherever their office was. The car would be parked during the day, and then they'd get it back again at the end of the day, and literally the family jewels. Now that boxy geometric style called the International Style was very prevalent for about 30 years. And if you keep building like that without a lot of variation, you open yourselves up to criticism. And in the 1980s, a group of architects emerged called, because they came after modernism, postmodernists. And they were saying, you know, it's time for architecture to get back to its original intentions, which is to evoke the past or be contextual.
This one is right here on the left. It's the dark gray green building. It's from 1989 by Kevin Roche. This is the Leo Burnett building. Leo Burnett is a public relations and advertising firm. And this building is kind of an homage to the first skyscrapers, which were invented in Chicago about 100 years before that building. The other one is evoking a completely different past. To the right of the building that says 55, you see a tall, glassy building that looks on top kind of like the Parthenon. It's got that pediment, that triangular pediment. That is by an architect who is from Catalonia. His name is Ricardo Bofill, and he says, architecture is theater. So he deliberately wants a very dramatic, very overstated building. And certainly the way to do that is to cover it with this shiny glass and then add all the stonework, which you see. The stonework is strictly ornamental. It's not supporting the building at all. And then evoking the beauty that was in shiny glass. Gary Hundell, who is the architect, that's called 111, has described that as a meander, which he likens to wrapping and embracing the building the way that the Chicago River wraps and embraces the city. And that building has a very unusual function. Right here in the middle of commercial Chicago, it's apartments. It's residential. Next to it, flag and window well. That's the LaSalle Wacker building from 1930 by Andrew Ribori. Looks kind of like a big chair. And that chair massing or shape is a direct result by architects responding to a law in 1923 that limited the height of buildings where they meet the street. See how it has these two arms that are much shorter? Architects looked at the law very carefully. The law said where it meets the street. So they take their big tower and push it back so it's still legal. And that window well that you saw in the middle was very critical in the 1930s when lighting was not at all like it is now. And also the buildings weren't air conditioned either. We're going to talk about what's going on here over on the left. And this is where many of the first Chicagoans had their log cabins. So this, again, used to be a very commercial, very sort of gritty kind of area. Oh, this is exciting. Photographers, the bridge is going up. You hardly ever see that. And I can't see why it's going up. Oh, yeah, there's a boat coming. It's a recreational boat. You know, we don't have big traffic. We used to have this because we had big commercial boats. And imagine what that's like to open those in a bustling city. Fortunately, this is, you know, early on a Sunday morning. And we have a couple of them that have masked. If you want to look over to the left-hand side of the boat, you will see them going under the bridge. And notice how the leaves of the bridge are kind of like a teeter-totter. Is 333 West Wacker, which is generally voted by Chicagoans who live in a city full of beautiful buildings as their favorite building. Because if you look at it, you see the way that the building follows the curve of the land. It's green like the Chicago River. Chicago is situated on a grid, so the building has a grid on the front.
and it's painting the city back at us. This is from 1983 by Cohn, Pedersen, and Fox. We're going to pause here at Wolf Point. This started out, this was where the first Chicagoans had their log cabins. Most importantly, they also had nine taverns. Someone wrote back and said, I don't know about these people in Chicago, they have nine taverns and no church. And when we come back down, I'm going to talk to you about a lot of the construction that you see going on. Because if you're a construction geek like I am, this is just a fantastic time to be able to see these buildings. So you've got downriver off to your right, you've got skyscrapers including one view of the Willis behind you, photographers, and then all these other buildings that are going up. Bends in a sort of different way than the Diva does. She bends out, this building curves in. Next to it, the pink building started its life in 1898 as a 10-story refrigerator, but when it was made into condominiums, what do you do with the refrigerator? You have to defrost it, right? It took a year and a half to carry all the insulation out of this building, and when they did, it cracked. So you see where the stars are, they ran big pieces of steel through the building, and that was to kind of reinforce it, and then they cut more windows in. You can see how thick the walls are. The building is almost soundproof as a result of that. That was done by an architect named Harry Weiss, who also did these cute little cottages that you see over here on the left-hand side. They're called the River Cottages. There are four of them there. And right here under the bridge, just to our right being the East Bank Club, 10,000 sweaty members. Includes President Obama and Oprah when she's in Chicago. But notice it does not have a lot of windows, and what windows it has are dinky. Because in the 1970s nobody wanted to look at the Chicago River. They thought of it sort of as an open sewer. And the building is literally turning its back on the river, which is very different than the way that we think of the river now. It's looked at as an amenity. And so I hope you're up top. And you'll also notice the one bridge that we went under, which is stuck in the permanently upright position. But if you look to the right, you will see that there's an apartment building that's right behind that. It is very glassy. That's difficult to tell with the sun right in our eyes. And also on the left, you have this development called Kinsey Park, which is from 2002. And you'll see that everybody has their own private patio. But along here on the left is this beautifully manicured walkway. In the mid-1990s, this is where these people and the dog are standing. The city of Chicago voted through an ordinance which said that if you built along the river, you could not just go all the way out to the riverside and prohibit people, citizens of Chicago, from simply enjoying the ability to walk along the river. So now if you build along the river, you have to have open leeway and access for people to come through. On the right-hand side is another building which is kind of evoking our commercial past. This was a warehouse from 1908 by Nimmons and Fellows. And notice that instead of cutting the balconies in like they did in the refrigerator building, here they're hanging them on the outside. Now, I'm a native Chicagoan. I love the city. But I will say that you can use a balcony like that maybe 4 months out of the year. But this is the sure way to tell residential. They have got to have their balconies, and everybody's got them. And you'll see people out there in January. You know, they have a down coat on, and they're poking the steak on the grill. You can just sort of see them saying, I paid for this balcony, so I'm going to use this balcony. So this is River North, highly residential. And this sort of grand dame of up here is over here on the right-hand side. You see the building with the upside-down Vs on it. That is Erie on the Park by a French architect who spent his whole life working here in Chicago, Lucien Lagrange. Condominiums so popular that 2 years later they built a younger sister. That's not the middle, but the building to the right. And those upside-down Vs are doing more than simply giving the building an interesting profile. If you're going to live way up in the sky, you do not want to be swaying back and forth as the wind blows. But you also don't want the architect and engineer to fill up your apartment with a lot of construction elements. So here, Lagrange has moved the supporting skeleton of the building to the outside. That's called an exoskeleton. And those upside down Vs are making the building strong against the wind, but nice and open on the inside. The park that you see along here, including a pooch park, which is up on the hilly part, is named for Montgomery Ward, that man who saved the lakefront. He got all that money to save the lakefront by being very important, not just to Chicago, but to the history of shopping. Because now if you shop, what do? You go on the internet, but you're looking at essentially a catalog. Anybody who is over 40 who is on the boat will know and remember the days when a catalog was something the postman delivered. It had 750 pages, and if you dropped it on your foot, it would hurt. And that's Montgomery Ward's idea. He was a traveling salesman, the light bulb went on, that he could sell much more at a better price if people could look at pictures of things, pick out what they wanted. If they didn't like it, satisfaction guaranteed or your money back. And that went from a one-page catalog in 1872. Only 20 years later, it had 1,000 pages and there were 5 million of them out there. Made Montgomery Ward very wealthy. And with a lot of that money, he gave Chicago that wonderful gift of that beautiful lakefront you saw. This is where his buildings were. Some have come down, but the one that's immediately on the right, the Cream and Brown building, is from 1930. It was designed by a man named Willis McCauley, who designed stores for Montgomery Ward. It's an Art Deco building, which shows off very nicely with these beautiful brown key-like elements at the top of the first floor and then at the roof line. It's obviously not for managers anymore. It's got the balconies. And they've also made it compliant with the Riverwalk by cutting this kind of arcade through. So this was the managers, and they were at one point connected by an underground tunnel with the Montgomery Ward warehouse. That's coming up here on the right. And for those of you on the right-hand side of the boat, the front or the back, you'll notice that it looks like this building is kind of going on forever. And it is an extremely large building made out of concrete. It's from 1908 by Schmidt, Garden, and Martin. And these long, low lines that it has are enhanced by these sort of stripes that the building has. Those are called belt courses. And a belt on a building does the same thing that a belt on a person does. It kind of pulls the look together and gives the building this kind of long, lazy feel to it. Schmidt, Garden, and Martin were contemporaries of an architect named Frank Lloyd Wright, who he would consider himself the only architect the world has ever known. More balanced, he was one of the great figures of the 20th century. And collectively, they worked in a style called the prairie style, because it had these long, low lines, which were very sympathetic with the flat openness of the American prairie, and gives the building a kind of an organic look, less like it was plopped there, and more like it sort of grew like a big plant. The island that you see is an accident. William B. Ogden, the first mayor of Chicago, owned a brickyard. He was digging for silty materials to make bricks out of and dug too far, accidentally created the island. So of course we had to name it after him. And as we come around, if you look past the bridge where the water tower is, and then you'll notice in the river, those big old barges piled up. The barges have brought materials up and down the Chicago River. There's not much commercial traffic anymore, but Prairie Materials does call for it, and in a few minutes you'll see the other reason that we have barges, which is construction. But that's a kind of a little to keep the water clean or worry about any other kinds of things like that. So it was very commercial, very gritty. Ahead of us, you see a statue sticking just up from the white behind it. That's on the top of the Montgomery Ward Manager's Building. We'll see it again as the boat gets a little bit further up. There'll be a gap between, and the statue is standing on what's called a ziggurat, which is like a stepped pyramid. Her proper name is the Spirit of Progress Through Commerce. The docents like to refer to her as Our Lady of the Perpetual Discount. And between it, the building with the big white shoulders, that's a building from the mid-1970s designed by a Japanese-American architect named Minoru Yamasaki. And Montgomery Ward was an unusual company. They didn't believe in privileges for executives, so he was told to give them a building where there were no corner offices. And that's what he gave them. And so that building had to be turned into luxury condominiums, which was not easy. They wound up putting the bathrooms and the kitchens in the corner. On the right-hand side, here's another building that's telling you what it is, the Chicago Tribune. The paper is not written there. The paper is printed there. Also, Midwestern editions of things like USA Today and the New York Times. There are 10 printing presses in there, and when they are all going around at the same time, the building would otherwise shake. So what they've done here is essentially nailed the building to the earth by sinking these big piles all the way down into bedrock, which is as much as about 150 feet or 50 meters down. The big doors that you see on the side, originally they thought they could use barges to try to deliver paper and such, but you can see that that was not going to work very well because of the disparity in height. And frankly, no one in his right mind wanted to dig on the bottom of the Chicago River for fear of what you would find. Because since day one, Chicagoans, if there was something they didn't want or need into the river, we also had all kinds of commercial undertakings going on, so they're dumping all of their stuff into the river. And not to be left out, we also had the Union Stockyards. And that was not just animal waste, but very often animal carcasses getting thrown into the river. And this was so bad over time that even in the middle of the 19th century, there were all kinds of problems related to it. Because the river, we've been in the fork of the river already. The river used to take naturally a kind of a left-hand turn, which meant that it went east. Oh, you're smelling chocolate, right? It's not just that you're hungry. Back to the right side of the boat, not anything to look at, but something to smell, is the Blommer Chocolate Factory. You can go to their website, and it features which way is the wind blowing, so you know where you are in Chicago and where you'll be able to smell it. So anyway, we have the Chicago River just all polluted, and it's naturally flowing into Lake Michigan. This is also where we get our clean drinking water. So we've turned the river into a sewer, and as a bonus, we are also polluting our only source of fresh water. So what are we going to do about that? Well, some bright light got the idea, which we've used many times in Chicago, make it someone else's problem. And they did that by saying, you know, if the river could be made to flow the opposite direction, and instead of taking a left-hand turn up here, just keep going straight, it would flow into the inland system of rivers, it would go down, and we could send all of our garbage to the people in central and southern Illinois, and specifically our friends in St. Louis, because it would all dump into the Mississippi River. They did that by damming up the Chicago River. They dug a trench or a canal, which is lower than the Chicago River, blasted it open. We all know, thanks to gravity, water seeks its own level and westerly instead of east into Lake Michigan. So now all of our garbage is merrily heading down to points south. We avoided a lawsuit from our friends in St. Louis, but by dumping all this stuff and continuing to do so, I mentioned to somebody earlier that this river was at one point current. And it's full of algae, and so that's what's making it green. Particularly a group called Friends of the River, which is a public interest group, and they're out here in their canoes many, many times during the year, are responsible for helping to bring back the health of the river. You can't swim in it, but Rahm Emanuel, the mayor, is an optimistic sort of guy, and he is on record as saying that he wants to live long enough to see people swim right now. The Kinzie Street Bridge is not. It's an automatic bridge. It's actually from the 1990s, but you can see that they built it to harmonize with these earlier bridges, which are mostly from the 1920s and 1930s. The one that's ahead of us, which is in the permanently upright position, is actually a railroad bridge, but they do have to lower the bridge once a year to keep it as an economically viable asset. The rest of the time, and they never tell you in advance when they're going to do it, so we've never been able to take pictures of it.
The first one is over on the left. You can see the open area here where they have the construction elevator going.
This is Wolf Point. It's going to be called West Tower. It's completely residential. It's going to come online in 2016 and was designed by BKL Architects. This is how these buildings are built. Look up, you see a concrete skeleton, very boxy. The concrete goes in when it is set, then up come the guys with these big panels of glass. They bolt the glass right into the concrete and poof, instant building. On the right-hand side behind the portholes, you have a variation on that. You can see the concrete core at the top, but now you'll see outline, you'll see steel. So this is concrete core steel outriggers. This is River Point, which is a commercial building for 2017. The steel is unusual. The steel is much more expensive than concrete. Concrete is stronger, but steel is something that they call tensile, which means it can bend a little bit and the building adapts to its surroundings. And that's very important because if a skyscraper is stiff or rigid, it's not going to be able to move with the climate around it, and that would compromise it. And here you've got the crane, which is being used in conjunction with the construction of River Point. And up ahead of us, however, we have the granddaddy of all cranes. This is one of the largest cranes in the world. It is 2,000 pounds, so that's 2,000 tons, so that's 400,000 pounds. Here it is, and it is working on building 150 North Riverside Plaza. This is another building with the concrete core, steel outriggers. That's the L going by above us. You'll see that there's this big wall. Behind that are the railroad tracks. So this huge building is going in just on a strip of land, very, very narrow. When it is completed, because they need to have a lot more floor space than that skinny area, when it's completed, the building will sort of look like a wine glass. It's got this skinny bottom, and then all of a sudden it flares out. Because if you're going to build along here, you want to make sure that you get a bang for your buck. Because long ago, someone described a skyscraper on the left-hand side. We have a building that's not doing a very good job of that. It's from 1961. It has these really great sort of pleats on the side of it, kind of accordion-like. But you'll notice that it's only five stories tall, and yet it's really, really long. Last summer, the land under the building was sold. And in so doing, they discovered that the people who are in that building have a lease until 2019. So developers would love to put something in there, but that's not going to happen anytime really soon to be able to take advantage. And I would bet that the building that goes in there will probably be like 80 stories tall. Now, there is no loss of room in the next building up. This is the Civic Opera House from 1929. It does indeed have an opera auditorium within it. One of the walls of the opera auditorium is here where you see no window, right when the stock market crashed. So it was very problematic, but the opera company did manage to squeak through. And now, under the direction of its guest and resident muse, the great soprano Renee Fleming, it is the second largest opera company in the United States. You may hear the captain with his horn because you're going to come up and you're going to see residential boaters. This is a weekend in Chicago and the little boats are going to be out like crazy. I want to talk a little bit more about modern architecture, which we kind of sort of zoomed past on the way out. We'll use two buildings, twin sisters, as the test cases. Right at the side is one Gateway Center from 1965, and across the street is number two Gateway Center from 1968. This is really the story of the architecture firm of Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill, taking the ideas of the great Mies van der Rohe, which were very intellectual and sometimes difficult to understand, and turning them into a kind of a playbook for modern corporate architecture. All of these buildings are very austere. They have no ornamentation on them at all. You know, no columns, no little angels, no festoons, no nothing. Elegant, but austere. Second, they are not symmetrical like those neoclassical buildings are. They're very regular, but they're not symmetrical. And third, these buildings are about being kind of light on their feet and floaty. They're about the space that they enclose rather than the weight on the ground that they take up. And when you work like that, when you work with perpendicular lines, a lot of glass. Here's the third one coming up from 1971. Shows you can do it concrete and glass as well as steel and glass. When you have that basic shape, you do open yourself up to the fact that it's kind of boxy. It's a tall box, it's a short box, it's a thin box, it's a fat box,
it could even be an Xbox like we have over here. That was a building which was built for the Mercantile Exchange back in the days when they used to trade by hand signals. Now it's all computerized. But those X's are like the upside down V's on the Lucien Lagrange building. That is the exoskeleton. The final one is over here on the right hand side, and wow, this one is a lot different. Largely because it's from the 1980s. So Stefano does a building here and says, you know, there's nothing in my guidebook here which says I can't be green, I can't have this beautiful curved front. Notice the glass and how the glass is sort of pinched at the corners. It's called bubble glass, and it makes the building sort of look like it's inflating from the inside. So that's DiStefano talking about the fact that we're really a lot more, modernism is a lot more versatile than most people give credit for. Across the street from it is a building that looks like it needs to have its teeth brushed at the very least. That is the old post office lobby from 1921, and then they added a number of buildings onto it afterwards. It's been abandoned since 1996 and was finally sold about 5 years ago to a British developer who has never really been able to get it off the ground. On the left-hand side, you have a real weirdness of a building. The low building is the world's biggest slushy machine. That is N-Wave Chicago. And what they do at night when the electrical rates are low, they bring water in and freeze it into a kind of slush. And then during the daytime, they pipe it into the older buildings, which have got that old air conditioning that has the chlorofluoral hydrates in it, the bad stuff. And that keeps them from using the old air conditioning. And instead they can use something which is like $5 you could buy the post office. It's for sale. Now we did get a post office afterwards. This one had to go because you can see how big and really kind of falling apart the building is. There was no way that they could retrofit it for the way that they sort mail now, which is all completely computerized. So they built a new post office that's over here from 1996. We were hoping that the federal government would develop something really nice there, but they said, you know, we're the federal government. We do not have to obey the suggestions, quote unquote, of the Chicago City Council. So we're going to do whatever we do. And they did plant some trees, so give them a little credit anyway. On the left-hand side, the tall, newer buildings are from what's called Dearborn Park, because there are many people who live down on this part of the river as well. But the great sort of set piece down here is over on the left. It's a concrete building that I very often describe as a concrete beehive. It has those interesting windows that are shaped like human eyebrows. It's called River City. It's from 1986, and it's by an architect named Bertrand Goldberg, who went to Germany specifically to study with Mies van der Rohe, but then ignored what Mies was telling him about geometry and glass, because Bertrand said, well, architecture is a human pursuit. As such, that's part of nature. Nature has no right angles in it. So I want to build curvaceous buildings. You can't do that with steel. They pump air into the water. It never freezes. So the boats that you see there never have to go into dry dock. They're there all of the time. Before the captain stops to turn around and give you a beautiful view of the great skyscrapers of Chicago, I will note that behind this power plant, and people up top will actually be able to see the building, as the power plant gives way, look about to the middle distance and you'll see a low building with a kind of a pinky orange wall to it. This is where the great Chicago fire started. This was the home of, on DeKoven Street, of Mrs. O'Leary, Cow Daisy, who always gets the rap for starting the fire. There's the building with the red-orange wall. In a great moment of irony, that's where the Chicago firefighters have their academy. The city burned for 3 days. About 30 people lost their homes. The entire commercial area was completely flat. And if you have to find a silver lining, the silver lining was that this was Chicago, where we were out in it to make a buck, as I have said. And we had to get up and start earning money and rebuilding the city. And that kind of blank slate that was left, the ashes of the fire, was an enormous magnet to young architects and engineers with great ideas. And it was from their fertile minds that emerged the idea of the skyscraper as a specific architectural statement. Captain is going to turn and pause the boat, and you will have a chance to see the great skyscrapers of Chicago from the south really showing off. What is it that makes a skyscraper? Three things that are very easy to see. One, if you're going to be over about 10 stories, you can't be a masonry load-bearing wall because that wall will just collapse under its own weight. So one, you have to build on a steel frame. Two, if you're going to be going up and down all that area, you certainly are not going to want to take the stairs, so you need to have an elevator. And three, this is Chicago where we tried to burn the joint down, so you need to be fireproof. But Louis Sullivan also said one wonderful thing, and please look at those buildings and think about this. He described a skyscraper as a proud and soaring thing. And when you look at those buildings, there's so much more going on than just a lot of floors that make it tall. The building itself is a unified statement. And the idea of a tall building as an artistic achievement is the great legacy that Chicago has for architectural history, invented here on the ashes of the city that burned in 1871. Ahead of us, you know, the kind of 800-pound gorilla is the Willis/Sears when it was built tower. It's the second tallest building in the United States, 445 meters, 1,451 feet, 110 floors, 100 elevators, 16,000 windows, its own zip code. If you look slightly to the right, you'll see a building that has a statue on top, and then off the back of it is a kind of greenish building that looks sort of like a garage. The garage is the 1980 addition to the older building that it bumps up against, which is the Chicago Board of Trade. That had to be put on in 1980 because the Board of Trade building, again, being old, it was built in 1930, did not have the underpinnings for all the computerization that they now use to trade. So they put the addition on, designed by Helmut Jahn. The Board of Trade itself is our equivalent of the stock exchange, except this is an agrarian part of the United States. So we do not trade there gold, silver, bonds, those kinds of things. We trade wheat, we trade soybeans, and until recently we traded something called pork bellies, which to me is a great word. As soon as the trees go away, you'll be able to see the Board of Trade again, and you'll see that there is an aluminum statue on top that is Ceres, who is the Roman goddess of the harvest. There she is, kind of lording it over the city. Immediately to her left, you see the building with the dots and dashes. That's actually representative of superhighways and all the traffic on the highways. That's a condominium building from 2007 by Ralph Johnson. And behind it is the Royal Couple of the River. You've got the Willis Tower, tall, dark, and handsome with big shoulders. And in front of it, you have the cute girl next door who's pretty in pink. She is from 1971. By Cohen Pedersen and Fox. We know they're very good architects. They designed a very un-Willis-looking building in order to be next to the Willis Tower. Willis is perpendicular. That building is kind of polygonal. Willis is dark. That's pink. Look, the windows are all the same in the Willis Tower, but notice how the windows are quite varied in the other building. During the daytime, everybody is happy to let the Willis be the tallest kid on the street, but at night, it's not very dramatic at all. Whereas the top of this building, which is crenellated, meaning it looks kind of like a castle up there, you see those tubs on the top? Those tubs have 1,600 fluorescent lights in them, which make a light that is so bright, if you ever see it, you will never forget it. And it's very often known as the engagement ring, because the light is almost a blue-white light that a fine diamond will put off. Behind it, the Willis Sears Tower, when it was built, it was designed by Bruce Graham of Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, and he could not have done it without the structural engineer that he worked with his entire career there, a man named Fosler Kahn. They worked long and hard to come up with the perfect structure for a very tall building. Because a very tall building, you want to be completely open inside, so you have a lot of room to rent, but you also want it to be really glassy. Now the ideal for that would be a tube like is in your paper towels, But one tube is, you could really knock it over very easily. Put the tubes together in a bundle so they lean on each other, and now you have the secret, because now you can count them. This is 9 bundled tubes, square, 3x3, 2 stop at 50, you can see that on the corner, 2 stop at 65, 3 stop at 90, and the last 2 go all the way up to the top. So now you have a building, very open, very strong. The jagged top does what engineers call fooling the
wind.
You want
to twist it in what's called torsion.
So they took a long time and they finally got it right there. For those of you who want to get the western facade, after this building, you can look up to the right. Here's spot 1 for the Willis Tower. You get the whole deal, including the 4 nests or ledges on the 103rd floor.
Spaces and see that this is still railroads. This has been railroads since the 1840s.
It used to be working railroads. Now it's railroads that take people out to their homes and then bring them back from commuting on a daily basis. If you look way down the river, you'll see a red building that says Go-Go Air. And you'll see a kind of a grayish building, modern, just coming into view. And you'll notice at the top of it, there's all kinds of metalwork on it. Looks like the building is having a bad hair day. That is the Boeing building. And when we get close to the building, I will tell you a little bit about it. But the problem is, from when we're right on top of the Boeing building, you cannot see all that metalwork that's on the roof. You have to look at it from much farther down. Between the two brown buildings on the left is a beautiful stone-faced building, white stone-faced building. Looks like it's sort of wearing a tiara, and then it has this beautiful scarf coming down one shoulder. That's 300 West Monroe by Adrian Smith, the guy who did all the really tall buildings. Before he switched over to the really tall buildings, he flirted a little bit with kind of evoking many of the glamorous tall towers of the 1920s. When he was designed in the late 80s. And you remember that kind of glassy garage-like looking building I told you that's the addition to the Board of Trade? Well, it was Helmut Jahn's second attempt to design. The first attempt was turned down by the people at the Board of Trade, but he saved the drawing and brought it back. And if you look to the left, between the brown and the white building, you will see a navy blue building, silver corners, frozen waterfall down the front. When he showed the drawing for that to the people at the Board of Trade, they said, we don't like it. It looks like a cash register. But he repurposed. The building in front of it, 2 North Riverside Plaza, is from 1929 by Halliburton and Root. This is the traditional home of the Chicago Daily News, which was the great competitor to the Chicago Tribune. The Daily News is gone now. But this is their beautiful Art Deco building, which has a very strong feeling of Egypt to it. King Tut's tomb was rediscovered in the 1920s, and Egypt became a great rage. So this building looks sort of like a Sphinx. It also has obelisks out front here. And then across the street, here's the Boeing building up close. And you can just see the very end of all that metal that's on the top. So what is all that metal doing there? Well, the Boeing building is shaped kind of like a capital letter L. And here where the lower part of it is, we have railroad tracks, but the railroad tracks turn. They could not place a supporting caisson under the building. So this part here is kind of like a three-legged table. It has a leg, but the leg is doing nothing. What they did was to look to the engineers who said, well, we can do this on the principle of what's called a cantilever, which is a horizontal element that hangs off of a vertical element like a diving board does. And all that metal that's on top of this roof is acting as trusses, and it's pushing against the tall building, and it literally is being held up by the forces of physics throughout that. This was designed by Ralph Johnson. He told me that they had to go on a worldwide tour, a hunt, to find an engineer who had that ability in his bag of tricks. They did find somebody. They got the building up, and it has remained there, safe and sound, not falling off. Engineers and architects have to deal with a lot. Are the worst source of pollution in the world today. It's not cars, it's buildings. For instance, and waste. The Willis Tower, about 12,000 people work there. That uses enough energy in a day to support a city of 50,000 people. And that's just wasteful in a time like now when energy is expensive and rare. So in the U.S., the Green Buildings Council has a program called LEED, Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, for architects and buildings to remain within good guidelines. We're coming around. This is the end of Wolf Point. And you can see over where the blue is, you see the way the concrete is kind of stepping out. Tom Kerwin calls that an urban veranda. And people will be able to just sit out there and sort of lord it over the river and watch the architectural practice in retrofitting older buildings. And over on the left is the Merchandise Mart, originally from 1930. And in the 1980s, they completely gutted it. They replaced all the heating, the air conditioning, the compression, the plumbing, all of the materials in the public areas. And that actually has now a LEED certification. LEED certifying goes from certified to silver, gold, and platinum. And the Merchandise Mart on its interior is silver LEED certified. This building was originally built at the behest of the will of Marshall Field, the guy who owns the store that's now Macy's. He didn't trust his heirs to use the money wisely, so he left his money to his grandsons, but not until they were 50 years old. Marshall Field III was only 13 when Grandpa died. So the money sat in a trust until then. It started as wholesale, but that was 1930 and not a very good, didn't do well from 1930s. I remember it from the 60s, 70s, and 80s as a place where furniture makers, people who designed, who were brokers of material for like draperies and rugs, all of that would be headquartered here. And now it's kind of Silicon Valley under one roof. There are 9,000 technology jobs in the building. So it is fit for the 21st century environmentally, and now has a very big representation of technology jobs. And it's wonderful to see that right in downtown Chicago. It's nice to know that the city is keeping pace and has plenty of life in it for the next century. We have a Platinum LEED building on the river. It's behind the one that says the Chicago School. Sticking up in the air and looking to me kind of like a diamond almost, because it has that beautiful articulated facade. That is 300 North LaSalle Street from 2009 by Picard and Chilton. And it gets its LEED certification by taking in water from the river. They filter it for fissions, and then they spray it on the elements in the building which are creating heat to cool those down. And then they clean the water and put it back into the river afterwards. So it's a very, very good citizen. Now, if you look over to the right, this is Lower Lakeshore Drive, and it looks pretty bad, and it looks pretty scary. But not for much longer, because they are starting on these three blocks, the two we've just been past, and this one, beginning to renovate them and turning them into a public riverwalk. And we're going to see the first of the three riverwalk rooms, which are completed in just a minute. They're over here on the right. This is a good historic time to be in Chicago because they just opened this a month ago. There are three different rooms along here, each with a different sort of theme. But what connects them is that the idea is to get Chicago and its residents and its tourists back into contact with this wonderful resource of the river. Everything that goes along down here is completely free, no charge for anything unless you want to stop for food. There's a pomfrit and beer place, there's a Chicago wine bar, gelato, all kinds of things. It's very family oriented. Next year there'll be a fishing hole and a fish museum for kids. This is the River Theater. The next two down are called the Marina and the Cove. And all of it, or I should say none of it, is going to cost the taxpayers of Chicago anything. The money was borrowed
and we have to pay it back. And it's going to be paid back by vendors and rentals and things like that. You can see the high-end side. This is Marina City by the same architect who did River City, Bertrand Goldberg. It's a little earlier, between 1959 and 1967. Chicagoans who like to give the buildings names that are a little bit irreverent refer to those as the corn cobs. Bertrand called them tree houses. There's a very famous Steve McQueen movie that was shot here in which they actually drove a car right off the side of Marina City and down here into the drink. As a result of that, you do not park your own car. Someone will do that for you. The apartments are above where you see the half circles. And because the towers are round, not square, the units are shaped like pieces of pie, like wedges. Bertrand, we know, was a student of the great Mies van der Rohe, and to the right of his building is the only building on the cruise that was designed by the great Mies. It was finished in 1971. It was built for IBM, but it's now occupied by the American Medical Association and the Langham Hotel. Mies had died in 1969, but as an 86-year-old man in February of 1986, he demanded to be brought out here before they dug the first dirt. Because in the world of Mies, the site and the orientation of the building was as important as the design of the building. The result? Austere, intelligent, serene.
Adrian Smith, the architect,
positioned the Trump Building so that if you look at the two of them, if you stand on the corner, the Trump Building is actually stepping back a little bit. It's kind of like pointing at the Mies Building and the beauty and perfection of that architecture. The Trump Building was finished in 2009. You can see that it has these multiple levels that are actually below street level. It is the second tallest building in Chicago. Even the Donald himself admits that he had really good luck with when the building went in, because it was finished just before the bad recession of 2008-09. The building was about 80% occupied for most of its life, which is really good. And in the past year or so, they have sold all the units that they wanted to. They keep, I think, three of them for show or for their own corporate reasons. And that includes the penthouse, which Donald was asking something like $32 million for and actually wound up selling for about $17 million. So this is the back of the Wrigley Building. People may know Wrigley for its chewing gum, but that's not originally what they made. They made laundry powder, and they put the gum in it to act as a freebie, and the gum was more popular than the laundry detergent, so they stopped making laundry detergent and made gum. Here we have a bridge up again. Very exciting. I think this one is coming down, because I think these are these same, see the boats here, they're on their way from someplace coming up the river, and they're eventually going to go through the lock and go right out onto Lake Michigan. Our last great building, this could only be Chicago, that is the Tribune Tower. Busy top, flying the flag. The design is by Howells and Hood. They won an international competition that had over 250 entries. Many of those were foreign architects, so we were really hoping we'd get something good. But Colonel McCormick, who owned the paper, said, my money, my prize, my decision, I'll do what I like. He liked Gothic. So Howells and Hood, oh, look, you can see into the bridge here. This is really exciting. The two sides have like teeth, articulating teeth in them, and then they meet in the middle. And in this case, it's interesting that they only raised one leaf of the bridge. They can raise both, but they can also just raise the one. So there is Tribune Tower. Thank you, Colonel McCormick. And we're going to come around here where you can see one of the deckhands. See, that's buried below the bridge house. And again, it's manual operations. So I thank all of you for coming this morning. It's been a particularly photogenic day. I mean, the weather is temperate, the air is clear, the sun is out, the buildings are showing themselves off to absolutely their greatest ability. Louis Sullivan said, as you are, so are your buildings. As your buildings are, so are you. I hope that when you see these buildings, it will remind you of people like me who every day live in Chicago. We work in Chicago. Every day we love the city. So I hope you'll come back and see us. Captain Joe did mention at the very beginning that I'm a volunteer, so it's been my pleasure to be out with you today. As such, we don't take tips. If you have spare money, you could always join the Architecture Foundation. I think that would be a great idea if you come to Chicago often enough. If you're technologically acute and want to say something about us on Yelp or TripAdvisor, we always appreciate that. But there is something that you can do when you go home that will cost you nothing, and that is to look again at the buildings that you live with every day. Fight very hard to keep the buildings that are important to your community and its history. Make sure that the new buildings are green and contributing environmentally, because every day, in every way, design matters. I need to ask all of you now sitting up top to sit down. This is kind of like landing an airplane, so tray tables and seat backs in your original upright position, please. I'm going to get off first, and I will be delighted to answer any questions that you might have. And as we come in, I think this crew deserves a round of applause for a great ride.